Even in the summer months, you can watch our livecast every workday at 8:30 p.m. Be inspired and discover new perspectives at Pakhuis De Zwijger.
Welcome to you all from Pakhuis De Zwijger for the 12th edition of We Make the City Reset. From now on, according to Annemiek van Boeien. Summer's here and slowly the regulations concerning the intelligent lockdown in the Netherlands have been lifted. And we're returning to, to life as we knew it, the new normal. Or can we take this time and space to think about a complete reset, to analyze dysfunctional systems in society and change them? In this series, we will showcase a perspective of a variety of thinkers. They will reflect on the current day situation from their own area of expertise, but also with an emphasis on creativity and imagination. Our main guest today is Annemiek van Boeien. She's a professor in industrial design and design aesthetics at the TU Delft. And later in the program, we will be joined by Alfredo Brillenburg from Oslo. And he's an architect and a founder of the Urban Think Tank. But first, I would like to welcome with me Annemiek van Boeien. A warm welcome to you.
Thank you.
Yes. Thank you for being here with us. And as an opening question, I really wondered, how have you experienced the past couple of months, the start of the lockdown, the insecurity concerning COVID-19?
Actually, I realized that I was very lucky because I was behind my screen finalizing my book. And actually, I was still in that process. So for me, it was really a convenient situation. And I had time to think about other people who were not in this convenient situation. And so I didn't, I was not anxious, but I could really empathize with people who were, because they were not in the situation that I was.
Right. You wrote and published the book. We will talk about that a little bit later. You're a professor of design, culture and society at the TU Delft. What's the main goal for you to teach your students?
The main goal, I would like to open their eyes for cultural variation, for to become sensitive for differences. That we teach students to empathize with individual people, to understand their needs, their desires, whatever. But I also would like to make them think about where we come from, to learn from, to know where we're going to, and to see that, to realize that people are part of a whole community and that they are sometimes stick into that, and sometimes also we can help them to support them, and yeah.
Right, because culture and community, or the sense of community, is reflected in design as well.
Yeah.
Do we take that in account? Are we aware of that?
Now, I'm afraid that nowadays, maybe because of globalization, we start to think in general terms to talk about people. What I see is our designers, they live also in their bulb, and they talk about the elderly, for example, design for the city. But for me, it's important that that it's also localized, that we understand that there are different people and that some people are bound to their place. And that's maybe why I feel, and that there is no such a thing as one universal solution.
Right. It's interesting that you mention the generalization of people. That also reflects in architecture, and we'll talk about that with Alfredo as well.
Mm-hmm.
The book you published, Culture Sensitive Design. There's a previous book that you published, The Delft Design Guide. Can you tell us a little bit about that before we delve into culture-sensitive design?
Yeah, I started to make this book, to develop this book. It's a book that developed over years. And we made this book because there was a jargon and there were all kind of tools and methods that designers in our education were using and our teachers were using. And I felt like we need a kind of an overview of methods and techniques and to be able to talk also about all these methods and to use them, to utilize them. And so recently we made a new version and we also included perspectives for design. For what reason do you design? What is your vision on design? So we added a lot of different perspectives to make explicit what designers do and why.
Right. And those questions are very current in your new book as well. Mm-hmm. In a moment, you will present your presentation. And that has the title, Let's Explore Our Invisible Cities. What are invisible cities?
Yeah, that will become maybe clearer through my talk.
Right. In that case, just a little tip of the iceberg that you can reveal to us.
Now, invisibility has something to do with maybe a lens that you need to see, that you see something that's there but you don't see.
Right. I'm very curious. In that case, I will say the floor is yours.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you for having me here. Exploring invisible cities. It was the philosopher Herbert Marshall McLuhan who already in the 50s of the 17th century understood that with the invention of electricity, a perception of place and time fundamentally changed. This new technology led to the design of the lamp. In contrast of sitting around the fire, from now on, we were able to read a book, play games, chat, grow vegetables in glass houses, consume at any time and at any place. From now on, with one switch of a button, or even automatically, we were able to overrule natural processes, such as the rise and the set of the sun. And more products followed that made and are still making our lives independent and disconnected from the real world. Think of air conditioners, airplanes, televisions, and later, of course, computers and mobile phones. From now on, we humans were able to move away from the real place where people and other creatures and spaces needed to deal with each other. It made people global citizens that brought many of us a lot of freedom, comfort, and well-being. But it made us maybe also less sensitive and even blind, if we were not already, for the cultures that shape our lives. The corona crisis brought us back to the notion that there is such a thing as a fixed place and time. Actually, it elicited the fact that many people in the world are bound to one place, and that people in these places need to live together and to do something to do so and develop particular shared values and practices to cooperate. To cooperate and form a culture, different cultures. General laws based on scientific research and technical principles are being investigated to solve the corona crisis. But the crisis shows also that different problems are being exposed in various places and yet other solutions are devised. It shows the influence of the cultural context on our design solutions. And I think there is not something such as one size fits all. A solution for what? For whom? For where? Who's included? Who's excluded? Cultural and political influences will steer solutions in different directions, and cultures and subcultures will deal with the offered solutions differently. And I think that's a good thing. In fact, a one-way solution would make us even more vulnerable. Diversity matters, whether it concerns different design solutions or differences among people or other living creatures. Cultural diversity makes people and the planet resilient. But yeah, culture is a comprehensive term defined by an ongoing process of shifts in human interactions and experiences. How can designers understand it in a way that it is tuned to their work? In addition to the functional, technical, and economic requirements, it is primarily culture that defines how any designed object and service will perform and prove itself, a process that largely takes place outside the domain and the control of the designer, and nevertheless, a process that needs to be understood for various reasons. Now, let me see what kind of reasons. The pragmatic reason that designers often give when asked why they should study cultures is to avoid mismatches between products and their intended users. There are, however, other compelling reasons in the design process that you could consider culture sensitivity important. A particular outstanding ones are, for example, in the process of designing, in co-creation, in user test and participatory activities. Culture sensitivity can help to cross the chasm and to connect with people from various cultures. And it also helps to gain a deeper understanding of intended users about what people say and how they behave in context. What is personal? What is influenced by the cultural and societal context? And what aspects of human behavior are actually universal? This bigger picture leads to a deeper understanding that helps in the development of a design direction, or of a design vision, if you like. When we look at the history of civilization, we see that people have always been inspired by and learned practices from other cultures. New products, music, architecture, fashion, and other creations arise by copying, adjusting, and combining existing design manifestations from different places around the world. Designers can make use of these differences to find new and hopefully better solutions. In his book, Le Città Invisibili, Invisible Cities, Italo Calvino writes about Marco Polo, the scribe to the emperor of the Tatar, Kublai Khan, about the cities he experienced during the journey, during his journey, about 55 cities and their multiple meanings, always organized and constructed differently, where people with their different cultures have arranged their lives and surroundings variously. He writes about the city of Armilia, for example. It is nothing that makes it seem a city except the water pipes that rise vertically where the houses should be and spread out horizontally where the floor should be. As a reader, you gradually discover that they are all different descriptions of one and the same city. Marco Polo's own Venice in Italy. A city that in the past literally did consist of several cities, including the closed Jewish quarter on the site of the old iron foundry. The first ghetto, a concept that we, and that's sad to say, now know worldwide through the course of history. History. The cultural history and heritage of a specific place needs to be understood and taken into account. For example, to support people's sense of belonging and to avoid segregation and alienation. but also to know to what extent change is possible, to what extent people are willing to change. Let's go to a practical example in the fields of product design. Product designer Jelle Zijlstra designed a bicycle hanger in the 1990s, which should reclaim space in the public domain from the dominant presence of the car. And that was long before the stimulation programs to promote cycling started. The bicycle hanger illustrated how difficult cultural change is and was. The hanger was designed to fit in a car lot park, a parking lot. In Rotterdam, the hanger was a great success and caused long waiting lists. People bought new bicycles again because they could be stored dry and safe against theft in inner cities where houses often do not have a bicycle shed. But initially, almost all hangers were mounted on the sidewalk. The holy cow did not have to give up its place. The pedestrian had to hand in. And it's only now, after more than two decades, that the bicycle hangers are on the street and car owners give up their parking space. The book. Culture in our book is approached as something dynamic, not static, and is certainly not limited to preferences for certain design styles. It's a response to the need to understand these cultural processes in the context of design and product design in particular. The book provides a lens through which to look at culture, to make visible what is invisible. In the first section, the reader will be introduced to the concept of culture and invited to reflect on his or her own culture. What is your cultural background? How does it influence your thinking and your work as a designer? The second section provides a design-related language in which to talk about culture. It introduces terms borrowed from anthropology, design history, organization management, and sociology. Terms such as global culture, subcultures, folk culture, acculturation, they are introduced in a way that designers can use them. Then the third section offers models and methods by which to study culture in the context of a design project. And the book finishes with examples, cases from the real world that have proven their impact on almost all cultures and societies. A number of examples show that products once designed from a specific particular use get symbolic value over time. Densely populated urban areas are emerging in this time of globalization and migration. These are cultural melting pots within which new cultures and subcultures are formed from a mix of cultural influences, technological developments, and a global communication network. These changes will lead to, as yet unknown, new definitions of social organizations and economies. And that will lead not only to new forms of rituals, utensils, products, symbols, but also to a need for other design disciplines and other design processes. Let's explore what is yet invisible. Thank you.
Thank you so much. It's very interesting. It's really interesting what you mentioned about the different cultural influences and the awareness that you as a designer have to have in order to understand your own design process. Can I start by asking, what are your influences?
Yeah, sure. I was born on an island. So, and when I reflect on my background, then I think, oh yeah, I was born on an island. There was a lot, religion was an important part of this island. In my family, we, of course, you also have a family culture. Mm-hmm. We were taught to empathize with different people in different cultural groups. So there was already something of an awareness, maybe. On the other hand, on the course of my life, I started to understand, oh yeah, but I'm still in a kind of a bubble. Mm. And but then I started to travel in the 90s to different places in the world, and as a designer. Mm. And then I realized, oh yes, I was in my bubble.
And what island was that? Because I'm very curious now.
It was in Zeeland, in our province in Zeeland.
Right.
Yeah.
What I find interesting as well is that you describe cultural diversity as a virtue, as something that deliberately adds to a process.
Yeah.
Why do people still concern it as something that is threatening, threatening their own culture?
Yeah, good question. What is, I think it's a kind of a human mechanism that people need to belong somehow to a group. They want to belong to a certain group. If you're different and you don't resonate with this group, I think it's also kind of a human reaction to think that people start to become uncomfortable. A lot of people like to recognize themselves in another person or to feel safe within a group. Mm-hmm. And if we learn that you can live in different groups and then still feel safe, that would an ideal probably. But the mechanism of thinking in they and we, is a very strong mechanism.
Right.
And
there's an example about that, because it's easy to judge something that's not part of your own culture, and it's easy to adapt to something that suddenly became part of our culture. There's an example you had about with mouth masks.
Yeah.
Can you tell us a little bit about that, please?
I wrote an article about a mask during the crisis, and there were also students working on a project. Actually, before we had the corona crisis here in the Netherlands, in China there was already something happening. Mm. And Chinese students in our faculty were wearing the mask already.
Yeah,
and
the virus was not prominently here in the Netherlands yet.
Yeah.
And they already started wearing mouth masks.
Yeah. And they noticed that there were kind of, you could even say discriminated, but they felt stigmatized in the streets. Mm. And then, but if you then understand also the history and you understand why people wear masks, and that it's not only because of this crisis, but they had other moments in history that, and also the pollution and other factors, you start to understand that there is another meaning of wearing this mask than people were used to in the Netherlands. For example, in the Netherlands, it's where people are very sensitive for covering the face. Mm. It's not transparent in a way. And so people feel maybe not safe when another person is wearing a mask.
But what people that see the mask do not always realize, it's also an act of solidarity. It's not only to protect yourself, but also to protect the other.
Yeah,
right?
And I think we learned super fast because in a few weeks we started to understand actually the meaning of the mask, and then you saw also new meanings arise. Like the mask as a way to protest, or the mask as a way to express we are the good ones and you are the bad one who doesn't. So there was immediately it became clear the design has a symbolic meaning actually for people. It's known, and I'm. Maybe it's good to know my background also from my work, my profession, because I'm working in a more technical environment and in a technical university with engineers. So they tend to start from the utilitarian perspective while designing.
Yeah.
the mask that should be safe,
yeah.
But it becomes easily also cultural and even political.
My final question, and I hope you can keep it short because of time, and that's a question of morality. By wearing a mask, should the Dutch Chinese student have been aware that in Dutch culture, people perceive it as threatening, so they should abstain from wearing masks? Also, should Dutch culture be more involved in Chinese culture, for example, or Asian culture, where you can understand why people are wearing masks? Who is to decide what step one should take?
A good question, but to keep it short, I think it should come from both sides. Mm. And also when we talk about integration, it's always from one side. But I think, the most fruitful way is to come from both sides and to see, to become sensitive for the meaning.
Right. Thank you so much for now. We will return to you.
Yeah.
But first, I would like to introduce our next speaker. Alfredo Brillenburg is an architect, as I said, and the founder of the Think Tank. And we've got a short clip to introduce him.
I practice the kind of architecture that I've always wanted to practice. When I was in school, I dreamt of being like the great architects that I was studying, obviously. And if you really get into history, you'll see that Le Corbusier, for instance, was in his practice of architecture and his formal output was directly related to social concerns. His architecture was a response to his era and his generation with new materials and new ideas. And he was trying to solve, at that moment, industrialization and also urbanization. Same with Alvar Aalto in his country in Finland, or Mies van der Rohe or Frank Lloyd Wright for that point. All of them were doing architecture because they had these social and utopian beliefs about changing the world. And that's what I practice, and now I've gravitated through New York to Switzerland, where I'm trying to do a global practice, but concerning informal settlements around the world and trying to bring infrastructure and social equity to those places.
Welcome and thank you for joining us today. You've seen the presentation by Annemiek. What's your first reaction in regard to her presentation?
Well, I think it's very important to talk about culture. I think architecture is pure culture. Maybe the most wonderful expression, if you think of cities, and especially now during COVID, right, as the greatest expression of civilization, of mankind, architecture is obviously all about that culture that is expressed in each city.
Mm. We've got a couple of superstar architects that work worldwide and we recognize their designs. But you're very critical of those kind of architects, aren't you?
Well, look, the economies of scope have beaten out the economies of scale, right? And this approach is a system of excess. And you can see it in the economic sector, or you can see it even in the surface of modern architecture. It's all excess. In fact, even product design is excess. If we were to really think about the key issues, let's say now world is in a shifting paradigm post-COVID or in COVID, we need to think about things that really matter. So I hardly look at any architecture that is that doesn't have its a reflection on attending social impact. And in that sense, I'll extend it to design, to product design. We are inundated with useless objects. Yeah. In this postmodern society that we live in. And I really would like to see a change in kind of the hierarchy of where design is going. And yes, reflecting culture and reflecting context. And however, I think there are moments, the 1920s, the 1950s, the 1980s are all different moments in which design has reflected its moment and its time. And I think we are living post 9/11 and now in COVID, we're living in a time in which design must address the most needy.
But if we take a look at post COVID-19, we've experienced that architecture during the lockdown, at least in the Netherlands, but also in other cities, it wasn't the most convenient. Houses were too small to be, you know, inside. And the city in Amsterdam is only growing. They expect it to reach 1 million people in 2030. What, as an architect, should we do to involve culture more in a denser city? How should we go about it?
Sure, that's a good question. So if we move from just the apartment unit, we can see, of course, people have been buying new furniture. Furniture became a great thing to think about while you're living in the space and lockdown. But then you also, the balcony became a super important element. So buildings should all have balconies so that we can reach out to fresh air. I mean, zoning rules must be changed on historic buildings that have no balconies. And they should really allow a whole refurbishment of facades of buildings, no matter even if it is historic, to allow for balconies. I mean, that happened in New York after the Great Fire in the 1890s, where all townhouses, brownstones in New York, are refitted with stairs on the outside for a fire that became fire escapes, which later became iconic in Warhol's films. We are in a time where we have to rethink the city. So let's move from the apartment unit to the public space. We need more public space. We need to rethink our public space. But then let's move further and say we've got to get rid of cars. Cars play no role anymore. With bicycles, electric scooters, mobility, freedom to walk, etc. Cars are really a bother. And we can limit their access to the city for deliveries at certain hours of the day, and that's it. So we have to rethink the city at a large scale. And I think that goes hand in hand with the unit.
Right. And rethinking the cities in a large scale, how would you react to my statement that 3 weeks ago, the momentum was there to rethink the city. Now summer's here, regulations are lifted. I already saw the traffic jam in front of a parking lot, a parking garage at a store. So we're returning to normal. And especially when the vaccine is here, we forget about the crisis we just had. Are we too late? Is the momentum gone, do you think?
Well, of course, because the momentum is not necessarily gone. If you see the movements in the United States, Black Lives Matter, etc., and all over the world for that matter, this is all the sign of the times. This is actually what I'm talking about when I say this is a very important moment, like 9/11, where for the first time, the Twin Towers and architecture was the object of a world attack. But basically, it was an attack that just evidenced the discontent with globalization, right? And so now we are living in a moment where politicians, or status quo, where the car, of course, plays that role in status quo, the car industry, is at odds with a growing movement that wants to change society as we know it, and be progressive and rethink the political arena and rethink the commons, or what we call what is true democracy. That's why when you vote, it's probably an epiphany of a moment, because that's the moment in which we are most anonymous and we can most exercise collectively our power.
Right.
So I do think that change is coming, and the powerless, the invisible voices will be made visible.
Right. And a new generation of architects who will be socially engaged are very important in playing that role or taking up that role. You will be in Rotterdam here to teach as well, right? That's in October?
Yeah. Yes, we'll be at the Independent School for the City in Rotterdam. Wonderful. October 15th, we'll be giving a two-week workshop on creating collective housing or cooperative housing, a very old concept, but all about designing your own house and your own apartment building together with friends.
and people are invited to participate in those workshops, right?
And the project will be a real one. We will try and build that collective building.
That's amazing. Thank you so much for now. We will return to you later because we still would like to have your opinion on some certain topics. We'll talk to you in a moment, but first I would like to go to Annemiek. Because you brought two clips with you that you would like to share with us, can you introduce the first clip, please?
Yeah. The first clip is a classic one, made in 1977, I thought. And it's made by Charles Eames and Ray Eames. And it's actually showing the world and maybe also the vulnerability of our world. Mm. And what I like from this clip, film, is that it shows what actually designers should do, in my opinion, is to zoom in and also to zoom out.
Let's have a look.
The picnic near the lakeside in Chicago is the start of a lazy afternoon, early 1 October. We begin with a scene 1 meter wide, which we view from just 1 meter away. Now every 10 seconds we will look from 10 times farther away, and our field of view will be 10 times wider. This square is 10 meters wide. And in 10 seconds, the next square will be 10 times as wide. Our picture will center on the picnickers, even after they've been lost to sight. 100 meters wide, the distance a man can run in 10 seconds. Cars crowd the highway. Powerboats lie at their docks. The colorful bleachers are Soldiers Field. This square is a kilometer wide, 1,000 meters. The distance a racing car can travel in 10 seconds. We see the great city on the lake shore. 10 to the fourth meters, 10 kilometers. The distance a supersonic airplane can travel in 10 seconds. We see first the rounded end of Lake Michigan, then the whole Great Lake. 10 to the fifth meters, the distance an orbiting satellite covers in 10 seconds. Long parades of clouds, the day's weather in the Middle West. 10 to the sixth, a one with six zeros, a million meters. Soon the Earth will show as a solid sphere. We are able to see the whole Earth now, just over a minute along the journey.
Yeah, zooming in and zooming out. It makes you very humble, doesn't it, if you see this, if you see that we're such a small part of the universe, and if you realize, if you zoom in, what happens inside of your body. Why is that important for designers?
Nou ja, actually, to understand also the effects of what we design. And I totally agree with Alfredo that we should not design so many lifestyle-like products. There's so many already, and we don't need that anymore. And but when we zoom out, we see what the effect also is of our designs on the environment, mm-hmm. On other people. We see also maybe better that there are different people in different places, that we have different climates, also physically. Yeah, we also see when we zoom out, we can think of, last week there was a message in our university about designing a toilet for airspace. Mm. And then I was thinking, yeah, okay, do we really want to design this toilet for airspace? What are we doing there? Yeah,
it's really space, not in airplanes,
yeah,
but really in
so,
space.
So yeah, this movie zooms very far out, and then you start to see, oh, it's quite empty for a long time in space. And what we are going there. What are we going to do there? So yeah, it's about the effects probably.
Concurrent with what Alfredo said about the excess, and there's no need for excess anymore. But isn't there also a difficulty because a whole economic system is built on excess, at least in the Western world, on consuming. What alternative system should you have if it's not about growth, if it's not about excess? Excess.
Yeah, that's the difficulty where we're exactly in, that we think, oh, we need growth for our welfare. Mm. And somehow a lot of people got, it's not an easy question to answer, I think.
But it's a system we have now, so yeah. Shouldn't there be an alternative? Because in other episodes of this series, people said we should focus on something else. Kees Klomp, for example, said we should focus on well-being instead of the gross national product. Is that something that you...
In a way we were focusing on well-being, because if you for example study the book of Factfulness from Hans Rosling, he shows that actually a lot of people's well-being has improved, also for the very very poor. There's still 800 million who are really poor, and they should not be, in my opinion. But somehow the welfare was growing for people. But now I think we see that we need to be smarter to see how we can, because it's there are also excesses. You don't need that much material to have a comfortable life. Mm-hmm. So I think it's about comfortable life, and also and maybe we also need to accept the end of the of life. Mm.
The end of life.
Yeah, even that. I think there are now, we go beyond well-being in some people, in our consumption.
Right.
And so we need to become smarter, to think more about how can we live more, not in a growth, but in more in a cycle.
Right. Alfredo, that's something that you mentioned as well, get rid of the excess. And... what should we have instead of that? How can we replace it?
That there's not enough to design. There's tons to design. I mean, even in America, in United States, there's incredible inequality. And so, yes, people have been lifted out of poverty. Chinese, 400 million, they say, right? Those are the numbers. But look where they put them. They finally went maybe from a slum house to an apartment building, you know, 30 stories tall in Shanghai, on the outskirts, completely isolated, with no work nearby. And the apartment buildings are already breaking down because they were cheaply constructed in these vertical pigeonholes, right? So what I'm trying to say is that it is poverty that creates the sites of desolation where poor people live. It's not the environment that creates poverty. So, in other words, it's how badly we've designed the places, whether it's the ghettos or the apartment blocks or leaving certain areas as slums with no infrastructure, with no proper housing to reblock. And there's tons of work to be done. And I can give two lessons about growth. Of course, we need growth, but growth can be, we can dedicate growth to so many positive things. And just to let you know, Venezuela grew exponentially from the 1950s onwards to the 1980s with the oil wealth. Yet today, it has the largest refugee crisis of migration leaving the country. 5 million people, and we have a 1,000,000% inflation rate. Mm. So, remember, it's not GDP. It's also political systems. It's also the Gini factor of the separation between the wealthy and the poor. All of those things are being played out in the United States today.
Right, and not only in the United States, but also here, of course. And we have to deal with priorities and choices. So that's a responsibility of the political leaders, but also the responsibility of us to have a bigger understanding of solidarity. Do you agree with that?
Yeah, but I was thinking still about we're talking about we and again in general terms, and I think still that we should also, and also when we talk about growth and in more local terms, like in Europe we have the European Union and we have one euro and we have one rule to deal with economies, and somehow we should be smarter to be more to localize also our way of living, because it doesn't fit all, it's one size that fits not all.
Right, we'll talk about that a little bit later as well, but let's look at the second clip that you brought.
Okay,
and would you like to introduce it or shall we just watch it?
Yeah, let's
Just watch. Let's go.
Let's just watch.
Eh bien, monsieur, on vous écrira. Pour l'instant, nous n'avons pas besoin d'acrobates. Non, non, sortez plutôt par ici. Comme ça, vous verrez ce qui se passe à côté. Sans faire de gymnastique.
At that time it was made and it seems absurd, now it's reality for us, all the lines that are drawn on the floor where about where we should go. Why did you bring it?
Yeah, first of all, to bring some light in our difficult and very important and serious problems that we now face. I like the films of Jacques Tati very much, because they also in a light way he shows what design is doing to people, and that here you see a person who's kind of an alien in a world, a modern world where which is designed only for efficiency, and he's at the end, he walks like as if it's just normal. He follows the lines, and that's the fishbowl you start to be part of, and you don't realize anymore that you are in that fishbowl. And that's also happening, maybe also with the new regulations that that will be introduced.
But how should we go about it? Because the regulations are made for, you know, general safety.
Yeah.
I understand what you say, that one size does not fit all.
Mm-hmm.
But at the same time, you know, the excesses in you know, going places, not keeping a distance. How should we go about it?
Yeah, and first to be aware of it. That, for me, that's important, that you understand what's happening to people, to you. And I'm talking from the perspective of the designer, that you understand when you design something, that that it's not what you design is not neutral. You influence people's lives. And you have to think twice what you design. And I think cities, they're fixed places. If I design a mobile phone or a glass, people still, if you're lucky and if you have money, you can choose. But the fixed world where you're living is kind of, is steered by the people who design that world.
Right. And like Alfredo tries to do with Urban Think Tank as well, is to try and involve other people than architects in the designing process. We've got a little bit of time, but Alfredo, can you tell us a little bit more about how important it is to involve other people besides architects in the whole designing process?
Well, of course. Architects have to realize, and then this generation knows it better than the new generation knows it better than anyone, is that we no longer design for permanence. And actually, it's more like a temporary permanent. We don't want to own so much anymore. People have turned on to that because owning too much is like an anchor, and it's putting all of your capital into a weight. And rather, what we want is to be free and global and mobile. So I believe in the European Union as a concept, of course, because it was a beautiful concept of uniting Europe. However, it's not worked. Because it really, the vision, the utopian vision has not been realized. In fact, it's very divided still. In fact, we should go beyond the European Union and think about one world, the globe. John Lennon said it, right? It's curious that today, one of the best-selling albums is Bob Dylan's new album that just came out with masterful lyrics. Why do you think that's happening? Why is Neil Young, John Lennon, and Bob Dylan's relevant now? Because the 70s was cut off too soon. That utopian vision that the 60s and 70s incubated, it was cut off with an economic recession of the oil recession. And then globalization kicked in, and we are just tying the knot again with the 70s. We're just trying to have continuity in the thought process that was being born when Marshall McLuhan wrote those words that were just spoken at the beginning of your show.
Right. Well, I hope we can connect with that era as well and that way of thinking. Unfortunately, time is up. So it went very quickly. But what I take from this is to realize that we are in a rut where one size should fit all, but we should be aware of the fact that it sometimes doesn't, and we should look for ways in order to break that mold and make it more individual. Thank you for giving us that, and thank you so much for your contribution today.
Thanks.
Well, we've come at the end of this program today. I would like to mention, of course, that the studio course on the Independent School for the City in Rotterdam happens from the 17th until the 19th of October 2020. Make sure to look up the book Cultural Sensitive Design by Annemiek, and make sure to tune in every Thursday evening, 8:30, because then a new episode of We Make the City Reset is being published on the website. If you're interested in other programs on Pakhuis de Zwijger, please make sure to check the website. If you would like to make a donation, go to www.dezwijger.nl/pay, and there you can leave a donation that will benefit the programs directly in these challenging times, so to speak. I'd like to thank my guests for being here and for contributing, and I'd like to thank you for watching. Bye-bye.